think this also works. Thank you for that introduction, and it's a great pleasure to be here today and talk about the results of the Abide project. So I don't have to tell you that dementia, with an estimated 50 million sufferers worldwide today, brings very high costs, both financially and also in terms of caregiver burden. And Alzheimer's disease, being the most prevalent cause of dementia, comes with grand challenges. To find treatments that work and to arrange proper care. And I would like to take as a starting point today that a timely and accurate diagnosis is essential to allow choices, to arrange care, and to choose medication and prevent crises later on in the disease process. And the good news is that the novel diagnostic tests are among the largest research successes of the past decades. And when I think about these novel diagnostic tests, I mean MRI, where you can measure cerebral atrophy, hippocampal atrophy, biomarkers in CSF that allow us to measure amyloid beta and tau and phospho-tau concentrations, and PET, where we can now also visualize both amyloid and tau in the living brain. And these novel diagnostic tests allow us to measure and to demonstrate Alzheimer's pathology in the living brain, and that helps to make an accurate diagnosis. It also results in the fact that we can actually demonstrate this Alzheimer's pathology before the stage of dementia, for example, in the stage of mild cognitive impairment, MCI. And I think that we can fairly say that in memory clinics, the proportion of patients presenting in the stage of mild cognitive impairment is going up, is becoming larger. And when these patients come to a memory clinic, this is the patient journey they would have. They would come, there would be a diagnostic workup, the doctor would choose which tests to perform or not, then would actually order these tests, interpret the test results, communicate this with the patient, and come to a diagnosis and treatment plan. But how does this doctor decide which test to order? What's the best application when you order an MRI? Is it good to actually eyeball the MRI, or should you use complicated software? Is that better for the patient? How do you combine different tests? What if one test says it's Alzheimer's and the other says it's not? What does the patient actually think about all this? And what does the test result mean for this specific patient? And once you know it as a clinician, how do you explain that in the best possible way to a patient? Well, these are some of the questions that the Abide project, which Abide stands for Alzheimer's Biomarkers in Daily Practice, focused on. And the general goal of Abide was to translate the available scientific knowledge about diagnosis of Alzheimer's disease to daily practice. And Abide was a public-private consortium with a special focus on the stages before dementia, MCI, and we involved both local memory clinic professionals and patients and their families. And you can see that the project has formally ended, but in fact, results are still coming out every day, I would say. And in another way put, the goal of Abide is to make this patient journey more colorful, both before diagnostic tests, how to optimally use these tests, and after the diagnostic test, involving both patients and the family and professionals to ultimately come to a better diagnosis. And in my view, a good diagnosis means extract maximum information from the knowledge available to us, but also take into account what is important for this patient and their family. Take into account patients' wishes and preferences. And I would like to focus on you on a few parts of this patient journey. And first, I want to discuss what happens actually in the consulting room. How are the decisions made, whether to embark on diagnostic testing, which tests to perform, and how are the results communicated? And this taps on the topic of shared decision making. And shared decision making is when doctors and patients decide together which care plan best fits the individual wishes and preferences of a patient and their family when there is more than one reasonable choice. And the idea is that the doctor is, of course, the expert on the disease, but the patient and the family are expert on the individual disease process and their own preferences. And shared decision making has four parts. It starts with creating choice awareness. There is more than one reasonable option. The second step is to actually inform about these different choices, then together explore the preferences, and ultimately decide together which care plan best fits the needs of the patient. So are there more than one reasonable options with respect to Alzheimer diagnosis? Well, yes. You could say, I want a diagnosis, and you could also say, why would I want a diagnosis? So to diagnose or not. And once you say, yes, I want a diagnosis, then you can discuss which tests, how many tests, how much diagnostic knowledge do you want to have? So this is something that you can discuss and that you can differ on in opinion. So we did a clinical encounter study where we actually went into the consulting room and audiotaped clinical encounters both before and after the diagnostic tests in 8 different Dutch memory clinics, where we audiotaped 41 memory clinic professionals having conversations with over 130 patients and their families. And all these conversations were actually coded following a study-specific coding scheme. And we paid particular attention to what was the agenda setting? Was there agenda setting in the conversation? How was information provided about the tests and the test results and the diagnosis? What was the model of decision making on diagnostic testing? Who did the decision making? And what was done to promote understanding? And here are the results of this clinical encounter study. And you see that actually in terms of agenda setting, in the clinical encounters before diagnosis, this was hardly ever done, only in 1 out of 5 conversations. And then it was in very generic terms, to have a conversation about your symptoms. And the agenda setting, we are here to make a diagnosis, was never done literally. Most professionals provided information on tests beforehand and test results after the diagnostic tests. But they did quite little to promote understanding, so they often asked whether a patient and a family had any additional questions, very generic, do you have any questions? But they did not check understanding, only 6% before and somewhat more after diagnostic testing. And when you looked at how were decisions made with regards to diagnostic testing, this was really most frequently done by the doctor. And when we thought, why is the patient and the family not involved? We also noticed that actually patients or their families rarely initiated questions or asked for more specific information. And this was rather in contrast with a survey directly afterwards, where 1 out of 4, a quarter of all patients and their families indicated they would have wanted more information. They still had an information need. So it seems that there's still work to be done, that we could improve on these diagnostic encounters. And the question that we then try to answer is, which information should that then have been? And to answer this question, we embarked on a Delphi study. And we asked a large panel of patients and a panel of caregivers and a panel of professionals which topics they find most important to discuss throughout the diagnostic journey. We identified 44 topics, and there were 3 online rounds where all participants indicated what they thought was really relevant. And we thought there was consensus if more than 75% in each of the 3 groups had deemed a topic extremely important. And in this way, we came to a list of 17 topics that could be grouped in topics on diagnostic testing. What's the goal of diagnostic test? Why should you do a test or not? Test results, so if a specific test neuropsychology had been done, you should give the result of this specific test. Topics on diagnosis, how certain is it that this diagnostic test result explains my problems, my signs and symptoms? What's the contribution of these results to the diagnosis? And finally, practical implications. What's the next step in this diagnostic process? What about a driver's license and so on? There were also differences between the 3 panels, and this is also of interest. There were 8 items, and I would like to focus on 2 here. One is the difference between Alzheimer's disease and dementia, and the other is risk estimation for developing dementia if you do not yet have dementia. And for both these topics, it was clear that both patients and caregivers thought these topics more important than professionals. And when we dived into this, we found that arguments in favor of discussing the difference between Alzheimer's disease and dementia is that it's an increase in knowledge that can thereby help to reduce stigma, that each different cause has a different prognosis, has different consequences, and it can help you to prepare for the future. And arguments against that were also provided by the professionals is that it may lead to an overload in information and difficult to understand. And actually, quite something similar was seen for the risk estimation to develop dementia. So patients and their families indicate they want to recognize symptoms sooner, be prepared for the future, understand why some things happen in daily life, while the professionals would rather provide hope and do not want to cause unnecessary fear or anxiety, and they think it may be difficult to understand, or it could also be difficult to explain what it really means. So we then had a focus group to dive more into these differences with professionals and patients and caregivers. And then actually they all agreed that it's possible to discuss this risk of development of dementia, but only on the condition that the doctor discusses before embarking on diagnostic testing, whether the patient actually wants to know this risk and what it would mean. And this shows the importance of management of expectations. So we developed a topic list with these 17 topics, and this can help patients and their families to prepare for the diagnostic encounters and to empower them. And it can also provide professionals with insight into what patients value. So we see that this risk estimation is valued very highly by patients and their family, but it's really not that easy. And that is why I want to focus the second part of my talk on personalized risk estimates. Because if you have a diagnosis of mild cognitive impairment, then in fact the diagnosis becomes a prognosis. It's all about what can you expect. And here we looked at our own Amsterdam dementia cohort, where we had over 500 patients with mild cognitive impairment, MRI and or CSF available, and clinical follow-up. And we took into account age and gender and mini mental state examination, their cognitive performance, to interpret the MRI and CSF results as good as we could. And when we first looked at the patients who progressed to dementia compared to the patients who remained stable, we found what many have found before us on a group level, that older patients, patients with suboptimal cognitive performance, patients with more atrophy and more Alzheimer biomarkers are more likely to progress. But what can you tell the next patient who comes into your office? How do you translate a hazard ratio of 2 or a risk of 5 to an individual patient? And this is where some risk modeling, predictive risk modeling came in. And we came with these models, and they come with very nice isograms. I love these figures, but I added a case to actually show you how it works. So if you would have a patient, a female patient with mild cognitive impairment, 62 years old, and her mini mental state examination was 28, then if you knew nothing else about this patient, her risk of developing dementia in a period of 3 years would be 29%, and in 5 years, somewhat over 40%. But if we now add the knowledge that she had only mild atrophy and normal CSF biomarkers, then we can actually look her up in the graph and see that her risk is strongly reduced to only 19% over 5 years. And you can actually use this model to fill in any combination of these values and get exact probabilities for this specific patient. So these risk models provide an individualized prognosis, and this is especially useful, I think, to reassure if the markers are normal, but it can also be very useful to interpret what it means when you have abnormal biomarkers. So the next steps were validation, so does this also work for a patient who does not come to Amsterdam? And we also developed a tool to support communication. First, the validation. How about the rest of the world? So we took our Amsterdam models as a starting point and included data of almost 3,000 MCL patients from all over the world. Europe, USA, monocenter study, multicenter studies, and we did some really heavy statistics. And what it showed us is that these models really perform very well throughout the world, in every memory clinic. These models also allow to use different CSF assays and different MRI methods because not everybody used the same methodology. We updated the model to the new ATN system, which had become fashionable in the meantime, where amyloid, tau, and neurodegeneration are modeled. And we found that the model has good calibration. This is shown by the Herald C of 0.74. It tells you the model is not perfect, but it performs reasonably well. It also showed that it has good calibration, and you can see that in the graph, where you actually see that the predicted outcome very nicely coincides with the observed outcome until 10 years follow-up. So this was really nice statistics, but of course it's not that easy to use in daily practice. And this is why we built an app, an e-tool, which we call the ADAPT. And it has three components. It has a risk calculation component, but also a risk communication, how do you explain, and a conversation starter to embark on a discussion on diagnostic tests. We first defined the knowledge gap, what's known, what's not known, and then we had a cyclic process of development in co-creation with both patients and their families and local professionals to come with an app. And finally, we did a very small, I must be a bit modest here, very small pilot study on usability and feasibility of this first prototype. And the really nice thing is that this week we actually released version 2.0 from ADAPT, which is an improved version incorporating these novel models, which also incorporates a topic list, which I just presented, and has also an English version. And I should make a disclaimer here. This ADAPT is for research use only at this point in time, and the risk calculation tool is specifically meant for professionals. It's not a do-it-yourself at home risk model. So what does it look like, the ADAPT? These are just some of the screenshots. There's a conversation starter to see some example lines of how to decide together on diagnostic testing. Then we have the risk calculation tool that can actually calculate the risk and give you 1, 3, and 5 years probabilities of dementia for this specific patient. And then there's a communication sheet to explain the results to the patients with a very nice visual representation of the probability, because we know that works best. And with that, I would like to come to the conclusion that I think that the improved diagnostic test are among the largest research successes of dementia research, perhaps until this week, when we actually heard that there may be a drug at the horizon. But we do need to bridge the gap between science and clinical practice, and I think it's important to combine the best scientific knowledge with patients' preferences. Because ultimately we want to go towards a precision medicine approach in Alzheimer's disease. And I think these diagnostic tests allow a very precise diagnosis. And we also see that shared decision making is not yet common practice in the diagnostic workup of dementia. So we developed this topic list, which can really help to empower patients and their families. And we developed a conversation starter, which could inspire the professional on how to embark on shared decision making. And I really think that e-tools can help to interpret data for an individual patient, but also to support communication with that patient. And this has great relevance today, because a diagnosis is really the starting point to arrange good and proper care, but also tomorrow, when curative therapy becomes available. And I just mentioned it, that with the novel results on aducanumab from Biogen, this tomorrow may be actually closer than we have thought. And with that, I would like to thank, but not before showing you the entire group and also mentioning all about project partners, because this was really an endeavor of many. And I would like to specifically mention Ingrid van Maurik, Agneta Fruitier, and Leonie Visser, who did a lot of the work that I presented here today. And please be welcome at Parallel Session P2, where they will tell about more about these results. Thank you.